Hey guys, welcome back. It's been a while since our last video, but that's because we've been hard at work on light. In fact, we've really updated the way that we're thinking about light, particularly as it relates to the motion of the filaments that connect atoms. And this is kind of a funny story because it seems like we've actually rolled back to a much earlier conception about light, which we hinted at in the blog that's been posted in all of our videos. But we kind of got away from it, and the way that we rediscovered it's kind of interesting. So we had a friend visiting who is an engineer, and simultaneously we had received this cool kit which allows you to model electric circuits in a mechanical way. It's called Spintronics, and we'll be bringing this kit in more and more as we talk about the intricacies of electricity and magnetism. But the first thing that my friend did was he set up an LC circuit, and the LC circuit's kind of interesting in real life, but also in this mechanical model, because what you can see is that as you charge up this capacitor and you let it go, the inductor, which is this thing with three balls on it, oscillates back and forth. And so what you set up is essentially an alternating current as it reflects against this capacitor. Well, I realized that antenna and radio waves in general seem to center around these kind of LC circuits. And it got me thinking about how antenna and radio waves are actually some of the best instances that we have at understanding what the surface of the atom is doing during light, which was really important to us in understanding the final details of what's happening in the filament. You can't actually go out there and measure a filament because, well, they're extremely tiny, they're entirely hypothetical, and so the best thing that you have is looking at what the atoms are doing on either side. And what better place than radio waves, because radio waves are how we control and generate light. It's long wavelength light, but it is light. And what we found was that fundamentally, in an antenna, the process is oscillatory. That is, the poles of the atoms involved, the polarity of the atoms, is changing on each half wavelength of light. So this really got our gears spinning, because we realized that it wasn't just radio waves that were doing this. All of light seemed to involve this inversion of polarity of the signal as it was transmitted from the emitter to the receiver. There's this oscillating electromagnetic field is how it's described. But in reality, all we know is that at the emitter, there's an oscillating electromagnetic signal, and at the receiver, there's an oscillating electromagnetic signal, which is received. Well, under our model of electricity, charge, or let's say the polarity, which direction plus or minus, has to do with which direction that surface of the atom is twisting. So under our model, this means that during light, the surface of the atom is twisting back and forth, and that's commensurate with a wavelength of light. So we were like, what in the world could the filament be doing to drag the atom back and forth?
We have filaments that reach out and are in between the emitting atom and the receiving atom. And before, when we had exclusively a breathing model, we had that there was this torsional twist that was being introduced into the filaments, that was the pulse of this torsion was what the light signal was. The more that we started thinking about the way that the change in the direction of the electric field reflected a change in the rotation of the atom, the more that we started to realize that that must be reflected in the filament. And so instead of having a breathing motion that's introducing torsion into the filaments, we still have the breathing motion because we know that that's commensurate with light being emitted from an atom. So you have a photon that comes into an atom, it excites it to a different orbital state, and then as it relaxes back down, it releases the next photon on into the network. Okay, so the breathing is there. But in addition to the breath, there has to be a rotation around the pole. So first it rotates to counterclockwise, and then it rotates clockwise. And that back and forth motion of the entire atom has to be sent into the filament. The simplest form of propagating light is a linearly polarized wave. And this was actually a huge part of how we figured out this new model of light, because we sat down and we started thinking about our old explanation for polarization, and we realized that it wasn't quite right. So we're going to do another video on that. But it comes down to the fact that circular polarization is actually a complex combination of linear polarizations. A linear polarization doesn't have any angular momentum associated with it. And so definitionally, in a system where you're releasing linearly polarized light, you have to be releasing a flat wave. It has to be planar. It cannot be torsional because there's no aspect of it that is able to give you that twist. The circular polarization comes from either the precession of the axis of the atom as it spins that gives you a spiral in the filament, or it might be from a complex motion that's of multiple atoms in the same substance that are all emitting at the same time. Like, that's a deeper question that we're going to get into. But for right now, we're basically like, look, the atom breathes, and the exhalation, as it shrinks back down, is combined with a rotation of the surface of the atom. And the energy of rotation is transferred into the filament, and the push of the breath pushes the entire wave front into the filament and out to the next atom, which receives it and does the same motion onwards and onwards and onwards. And this is, it can be reflected, it can be absorbed, it can be relayed. There's many things that can happen, and these are all things that we have to figure out the mechanics for. But basically, the update to the model is that instead of having a torsional wave that is the photon in all cases, we start with the simplest case of linear polarization being a planar wave that is released from the equator of the atom, where it rotates clockwise and counterclockwise around its electrical axis.
Which is essentially flinging the filament in waves which are oppositionally oriented backwards and forwards, and they propagate down the length of it, such that when they reach the receiver atom, they're telling the shell to twist one way or the other. And this allows us to explain all of our previous investigations into interference in a very mechanical way that's easy to understand. Because if a given shell receives an input to turn this way, because it's in one part of the wave, and then it simultaneously is out of phase due to the length of travel and receives one telling it to go the other way, it's going to do nothing because it's receiving countermanding information, let's say. So this is the simplest form of a photon, is this simple linear polarization. And like you mentioned, there may be multiple ways to understand polarization, and we're going to do a deep dive on that next week, or as soon as we possibly can. But we can imagine that if you take a slinky and you have this nice transverse wave propagating in it back and forth in a linear fashion, and then all of a sudden you rotate your hand around a little bit, you give some motion to the pole, you twist your pole back and forth of where you're oscillating it, all of a sudden the wave does become torsional and helical. And that's quite interesting by itself. And there may be multiple ways to deconstruct different polarizations, and we're going to get into that. But we think that this is a much more appropriate way of explaining how the electric behavior of the receivers is correlated to the electrical behavior of the emitters. And that's kind of what we're all about, giving a mechanistic, material-based explanation for what could be causing light.